So let's now go to the third part of this lab. The third part will implement an interaction with the system events. And the system event will be the temperature sensor, the internal junction temperature sensor. So the objective of this lab is to add a new widget, a progress image widget, to our first screen layout. This progress image widget has an internal value that allows to display part of a progress image. So it's the way to display a temperature, but also any type of value, but in a graphical way. We will use the CubeMX tool to configure the ADC IP and read the junction temperature, and we will implement the model view presenter in the model view presenter approach, the way to retrieve this value from the system and to display it on the screen. So we will review all the steps that are involved when using this model view presenter that was described in the theoretical slide set of this graphic workshop. So first of all, we will just add a new widget to our first screen. So we can reduce the detail log and go into the widget list. So in the widget list, we have several categories. One of them is the progress indicator. In this, we will use the image progress. So as for buttons and so you see here I'm in the wrong screen. So let's go to the first screen. So yes, I was saying that the basic all the widgets have a default style, default appearance. We will modify it to fit the custom images we added to the project. And by the way, all these images were provided by Mjolnir. So Mjolnir is the company that created TGFX and is still very active in the domain of consulting. So they are able to create an entire layout for you. So all the assets, as for these buttons layout, and all the image progress layout is also has also been created by Mjolnir. And but they're also very aware, of course, of the internal mechanics of the GFX library, so they are able to decide which widget will suit you better, or even create custom widget if it's needed. So they are still partners and important partners for ST regarding TGFX. So this is where the naming of the widget becomes really important, because this one will be accessed by the code we will add later in the source code directly. So it's temp sensor, I guess, no, temperature bar. So as always, small letter on the first, and then capital letter for each word. The location I will not bother about it for the moment. And we'll set the background image. So this widget has a name and a location as every widget, but it has also some attributes that are specific to it, such as a background image and a progress image. So the background image will be always displayed at all time. The progress image will be progressively displayed depending on the internal value. So that's the other attribute of the widget. So it contains the class, this widget class has an internal field, which is an integer that contains the value of the corresponding widget. So as you can see here, by default, that's interesting, because you can either pick an image from the images you added yourself, but also from predefined skins. You have a set of images that are available within the TGFX Designer tool. So that could be interesting also for your own prototyping. If you do not have time to create some skins, there are some available. So the background is this image, and the progress image is the colored one. So since it is a temperature, you can see it goes from blue to red. Blue is a low temperature and red a high temperature. By default, the position of the progress image is wrong because our background image is not at the top left, at the top left side of the top left location of the widget, which was the case for the default one. So we will have to adapt its position using this. So I will take the exact position from the slide set. So it's 18, 27. Two 144 and 18 again. So now the progress image is centered in my widget. Let's see if it's centered. Okay, the widget is not exactly centered. Now it is, but we'll put it a little bit higher because we will put some text below. But it is not correctly displayed because I want the low part to be always visible. So I need to use the anchor progress image at zero. And the initial value, this is the initial value of the internal field of the class. It will only be displayed a few milliseconds, so we do not really care because as soon as the program will start in our implementation, the graphical user interface will retrieve the internal value of the sensor and update this image widget after a few milliseconds. So we will only see the default the initial value for a few milliseconds. So we can put it to 10 maybe. So it's the internal junction temperature. So it's not the ambient temperature. So it will be around 50 degree, between 50 and 60 degree. And the direction is set to right, so the image progress will move, this part only will move from left to right, but the right part on part only. And I think we are good now. So the values goes from 0 to 100. Actually, it goes from 10. So in the slide set, it's 0, but let's put 10. It will be more precise. And then I will put 20 here. So it goes from 10 to 100 degrees. And we are done for the image progress widget. Then we will add some text area to label this widget. So back to the widget list. At the very bottom of the widget list, we have some miscellaneous section containing the text area. So again, I will locate it quickly. We set the text to white or not to white, to a specific blue. So let it put it to white. So you have three ways to set the color of in the tool. We can either use the color picker to change the color. You first choose the main color and then you can I can adapt. Or you can select the amount of red and green and blue, or set the value directly. But you can also put directly the hexadecimal value. That's what we will do to fit exactly what we define. So it's six value, so I missed two. Yes. And press enter to validate. And we set the text to junction temperature. And now we can center it regarding the image progress. So that's it. Almost, I guess, yes, it is that, it is it for the layout. So we can regenerate the codes. We see a blue dot indicates that the code is not up to date. So let's update And for the moment, we have no interaction with the system. As I said, this is not handled directly by the tool JFX, the JFX Designer tool, because it is part of the logic of the application and the designer only implement part of the logic. So through interactions, for example, or through the entire logic of each element. But for some at some point, you have to go directly in the source code to implement what you really need to do, and especially when communicating with the system. So this is what we already did in the first very first section. So what we have to do also, and which is not in this slide set, is to unzip the prepared code, the prepared source code. So let's go back to the very beginning. So depending on the archive you will have, you have two solutions. On one hand, you can get these two zip files that I started from. It may be that you have a file once only one zip file named like this. Underscore lab12. That means that in this zip file, you will have the original one plus the modified files. So you have already all the source code included but not enabled. In our case, the additional modification, the disabled source code is in this smaller archive. So as you can see, it contains a folder, a name exactly as the one we unzipped from this archive, but it contains only update of specific files. Specific files are domain.c on the core part, and on the JFX part, it contains the screen one, two, the logic that we will add in the three next steps of this lab. So all you have to do is unzip these two folders in this folder to it will overwrite the existing version. So I'm overwriting. And I have the warning, so that means that I'm doing the proper thing. So I'm overwriting main.c, model.hpp and other file from the graphical user interface. We will cover exactly what these modifications are. So I can click yes to all. And we will now launch the CubeIDE, the CubeIDE project, open the CubeIDE project. So as I told you, the default IDE is STM32 CubeIDE, but you are free to change it to another one. But it will have to be done in the IOC file, so the CubeMX project. We will see that just after when enabling the IDC. So the CubeIDE project can be either opened by double-clicking on the .project file or opening a CubeIDE and importing the project. In my case, I have the latest version of CubeIDE is the 1.3.0. I know that there is a more recent version, and maybe when you will watch this video, there will be an even more recent version. So if you want to be sure to have no impact on normally it should work also on a more recent version, but to be sure, if you have, for example, we are using 1.3 here, if the 2.5 has been released, just open the 1.3 version and import this project. So from this folder, import the project in this the correct version. In my case, I will just double click on it and it will open the CubeIDE project in my other screen. So this has the message that you may have if you are first launching your CubeIDE on your PC. You have to choose the workspace. So once you check this checkbox, it will not ask you again. And you will have an information center window displayed that you can close. In my case, I already selected my workspace and check this box. The workspace is interesting if you have several projects open at the same time, but not necessarily located at the same place in your hard drive. They will be all in the same workspace, so the information that are common to this project will be stored in this very specific folder. But if they have their own settings for specific configuration. So let's have a quick tour. So we find not exactly the same folder hierarchy as in on the hard drive. You can see on the hard drive that the folder hierarchy is not the same. So on the hard drive, the TouchFX folder contains all the graphical user interface, the generated code, in a top folder called TouchFX. In the CubeID project, it's a little bit different. All is gathered in the application folder. Then you have the graphical user interface folder containing all the screen. And this is the basic, the best classes, so all the translated images into C table, and also the base classes for these screens. So what is done usually with Eclipse Base is that the Eclipse project is based on the actual folder hierarchy on the hard drive and retrieves all the C files automatically and builds them. Here we use links and we use a specific project organization because some of the C code that is included in the project are dedicated for Windows. So this is for the simulator, of course. And this must not be built when building the target. That's why the CubeID project has a specific organization, but they are all pointing to files that are in this folder hierarchy. So this is the folder structure project organization on the left. Here you have the editing pane, so if I click on the main.c, for example, it will open the file. And okay, so there are some tutorials already on CubeID that describes how it is organized, and there is even an application note on this. What will be interesting also is the build analyzer that will be filled once we started to build the code. And that's what we will do just now. So let's start the build. So you can either right click on the project and click on the build menu, but you can also select the project. So left click on it and use the hammer here. It's also quite usual in Eclipse to have several ways to do the same command. So I will fast forward this build step because it's quite long. The build is finished and we can start now the debug session. So we will flash the board. What is important, first of all, it is described also in the slide set, is to be sure that the debug configuration is properly set, because the flashing will involve programming the internal flash with the actual program, but also the external flash. And to program the external flash, you need an external loader that will first initialize the internal flash with a bootloader. And this bootloader will initialize the external flash and copy the input bitmaps into the external flash. So this is a specific program that has to be implemented, this external loader. When you have selected your external flash, will have to be implemented by on your own, but starting for the example we provide. So to set this external loader, we have to go to the debug configuration. So it's a right clicking on the project, and instead of launching directly the program, you will go to debug configuration. In my case, the settings are already set because already launched several times this project. So in your case, what can happen? So this configuration should exist with all the parameters set by default. If it does not exist, you just have to double click on this target, and it will create this one automatically with the proper setting, except for the external loader. So let's see where it is. It's in the debugger tab at the very end of it. Here you have a checkbox that you must select. So in your case, it could be like that. You may open this configuration and see that. And if you click on the external loader, you cannot set anything before you hit the scan button. The reason for this scan button is especially when you will add your own external loader. You need to have a way to add it in the tool. So the scan button will browse the existing the Cube Programmer external loader that are available and display them as a list. So if I click on the scan button, now the list is populated and I can choose in this list. So maybe at some point there will be your custom external loader for your own external flash, and I will select the proper one, which is the H7B3i discovery board. So some external flash are common to boards, but usually we have different sizes, and so maybe you can see that on these two, the Disco and the Eval have the same memory. So in our case, it's H73 Disco, so it's this one. Then we can apply and we can launch a debug session. So I will display my board again. So now what should we see? We should see here the progress image widget that we just added. So the debugging is maybe can take a few seconds to launch. I advise you not to click on anything to avoid any error. So just wait. You can see here that Cube Programmer is used internally. And in the meantime, I can show you also where are located the external loaders. So it's in the installation. So the Cube Programmer is in Program Files, STMicroelectronics, STM32Cube, or anywhere you install it. And in the binary folder, you have here the list of all the STLDRs, so the external loaders that are available for all our boards. And you see that there are four examples of the source code that allows to generate these loaders. So we, of course, if you write to the online support saying that, okay, I want one that is not provided by default, because the source code could be huge if you put all the source code of all the supported external memories, we can provide you on demand without any problem, so that you can adapt it for your own memory. So the debug has started, but it stopped because it's a debug session. So we stop at the first instruction. And we can now, so let's not hide. So for the moment, the board is not initialized at all. It's just powered on. And if I click on the Go button, now I can see my new widget with the junction temperature label I put just in it. And of course, I can pause, break the execution and restart. So put some breakpoints anywhere I want. So now we need to go further in this lab, so to enable the ADC, because what we want in the end is not that this progress image widget displays every time 20 degrees. We want it to be ad to adapt given the junction temperature. For that, we need to first enable the ADC. So we leave CubeID open as I left the TouchFX opened also. Why? Because just to show you that how the development phase works. In fact, you edit all the graphical user interface from the designer, the layout of it, not all the logic. The logic is edited from the CubeID project, and the IP, the internal MCU configuration is edited from the CubeMX. And all these tools supports the fact of being modified externally. See, if you modify a file from the CubeMX because you enable the ADC, as we will do, the CubeID project will be updated automatically. You do not have to close the tool to edit the configuration with another one. That's quite convenient, in fact. So let's open the CubeMX project. So back in our active project. So the IOC file is the CubeMX project. So it is provided when you create your application from an application template of the TouchFX designer. So it opens, of course, on my other screen. So it contains all the peripherals that are enabled to run the demo as it is now. So the LTDC, the frequency, the internal PLL, the clock tree is configured properly. So if you regenerate the code as is, you will not lose anything. It corresponds exactly to the actual configuration. So I will not go in detail into the CubeMX layout because it's also covered in another video. I just want to focus on two things. First, in the project manager section, as I told you that you can choose whatever IDE you want among the one we support, of course. So we can see EWARM, NDK ARM, and STM32 Cube IDE that will replace, in fact, both System Workbench and TruStudio that were also Eclipse-based IDE. But when I say IDE, it's an integrated environment. Development environment. I forgot to say that. So IDE it's the short way. So it's a tool chain, but also a tool to edit and browse the code by right clicking on the types and stuff like that. So it is not just a text editor that you could use also. When you use makefiles, usually makefiles for compilation, you use text editor to edit your file. With an IDE, it's all integrated. So that's what is called an integrated development environment. So if I change the EWARM here, so I switch to IR, then I will have to regenerate the code, go back to the, so regenerate the code from the CubeMX. It will save this information in the IOC file. And when I will regenerate the code from the TouchFX, maybe after adding an extra screen or new files, the corresponding IR project will be updated instead of the CubeID project. So all these tools, the three tools, in fact, especially CubeMX and TouchFX, are linked through the IOC file. So that's important to mention. And the other point is that in this CubeMX 5.5, 5.6 even version, we have the support of the TouchFX, the Xcube TouchFX, which is the purpose of this entire graphic workshop, is to present this plugin. And this is available since the version 5.5 of CubeMX, we are using now the 5.6, and the version of the Xcube is not linked to the version of Cubemx. It was the same version at the 4.13 on the 5.5 version of Cubemx, and it will maybe change, will be switch in a few days, because I think in June there is a new release. It will switch to 4.14, for example, but it will still works on a 5.5 version of Cubemx and 5.6 version of Cubemx. That was also the main interest of integrating TouchFX as a plugin of Cubemx, rather than and as a configuration, an internal configuration of it, as it was before. So in this plugin, you can find all the information, the mandatory information needed by the TouchFX library to address the display. So it starts from the screen definition, the frame buffer strategy. Is it one frame buffer or two frame buffer strategy? How it is allocated? By allocation means that when generating the code, the Cubemx, the TouchFX plugin will declare an array, a specific array of 32 bits integers of the right size to contain one or two frame buffer. You can also put here a direct address to a specific location in your memory. It can be sometimes preferable to put direct address. In our case, we put by allocation. We also define the interface here, which will be LTDC. This is available because the LTDC is enabled. So there is also some guidelines, especially in the TouchFX documentation on the web, that describes how to use this plugin. We will not go into details. We are really focusing here on the iteration and with using a prepared project that is properly configured. And that's why also, normally, when you first create your project from scratch, from your custom board using Cubemx, you will get some warnings at the beginning in this section. You will have some pink lines appearing above the display section, telling you that, for example, the display definition does not correspond to the LTDC internal layer dimensions. And it will be, or for example, that the CRC is not enabled, while the CRC is needed by the TouchFX library. So this plugin helps you, guides you through the enabling of all the internal components of the MCU that will be needed for the TouchFX library to work. But to some extent, because this is also described in the documentation. Let me show you this documentation. Just a quick step aside. So in this documentation, so this is the address of the documentation. It is mentioned in the slide set also. What is mentioned here is that the, so I think it's the in the basic concept. So it describes what you need to be sure of before even starting to initialize the TouchFX library. What is mandatory is to be able to display a single color on your screen. If you are not able to do that, the TouchFX library will not help you. The TouchFX library does not really care about how you connect your display to the board. Is there a touch panel and how it is connected? If it's present, you have to mention it, but how it is connected is not his concern. You have to be sure that your memory is accessible, the memory where you will store your frame buffer, so usually external memory, external RAM. You have to ensure yourself that your settings are properly set so that this memory is available, is accessible, and same for the display. So please have a look at this documentation, because it has been released after the first release of the Xcube.jfx. But in fact, it's really very, very important to understand how the tool works and what is the TouchFX library concern and what is not. What is more your concern, and that there are things that cannot be handled by a tool. It has to be implemented by yourself. And I'm talking about the low-level drivers of the display controller, for example. This cannot be guessed and these are not supported by the CubeMX configuration tool. The CubeMX is really here to configure the IP of a given MCU, not the what is connected to this IP. So you can configure the FMC to connect a memory, but the memory itself will have to be configured by yourself. So back on our track, so this is the TouchFX plugin, and these informations will be stored in the .part file that we saw earlier when first creating the project, and will be used by the designer to set the proper size of this window, of this canvas, for example, and also to set, as we saw in the configuration, in the default image configuration, the frame buffer display color format is reflected in this default image configuration. When you will add an image, it will be by default of the format of the frame buffer, but it can be, you can change it if you want, but it will be the default value. So let's now enable the ADC. So the ADC, we will use the ADC2 to so this is described also in the slide set. It's in this part. So these values are specific to this board and can be found in the datasheet of the MCU. So in the ADC2, we have a temperature sensor channel that we must enable. And once enabled, we have some configuration that will appear. So the first thing is to set the clock prescaler to divided by 8. The resolution must be set to 16 bits, which is already the case. And then we have to unfold the rank section and put here 32.5 cycles sampling time. So let's go back to CubeID to show you another important thing. When you generate your code, if you are familiar to CubeMX, okay, you can fast forward. If you are not, be aware that CubeMX generates the code and notably the main.c file. But you can see in the main.c file that there are specific sections like this, and there are several of those in the code. That means that if I put something in this section, when the code will be regenerated, all the parts that are beside this section will be reset. If I put something here, it will be overwritten by the generation. If I put something, some instruction in these specific functions sections, so user code begin and user code end, this code will not move. So that's really important because, and especially in our case, because if you look back at the bottom of this file, you have here in user code begin and user code end, the specific code that we will enable in a few seconds that we add for this lab. So we will regenerate the code from the CubeMX. This part will not move, but I will go at the here. So here we have the main, so it's the main function. The main function. We have the main peripheral enabling. And once I will hit the generate code button, we will see that ADC will appear. ADC init will appear in this list. So let's generate the code. So normally this window should blink also, because the TouchFX designer will detect that something has changed in the .part file, which in fact it's only a warning and it's not relevant because the .part file didn't change at all, since we did not modify. You see it's blinking here, and the reason is yes, the .part file has been changed, but in fact it's just because the .part file has been regenerated again for nothing, because we already have our TouchFX project. but it is regenerated each time. So maybe there will be a fix in a future version of the Xcube, so that this file is not generated if nothing has been changed on the JFX plugin part. So I can say yes here to reload the project. It will not change anything in my project. And minimize it. So sometimes this generation can take some time, because it means it's a bunch of FTL script that will generate code or start from an existing C code and extending with the specific configuration. For example, the main.c file has a specific template and is extended with the init function of each peripherals. So that's really a file manipulation that can be quite long, especially in Java. So the code is successfully generated. Since my project is already open in KubeID, I will just close this dialog window and go back to the KubeID. So you see that the main.c just been updated. And let's go back to the main function. So you can see here that now I have the MX-ADC2 init function that has been added, as well as, of course, the corresponding instance of the ADC, which was not present before. But the source code I showed you just before is still present, has not been modified. So this user code begin and end section are really important when you are starting implementing your application. So the next step is to enable this, because now we have the IDC is initialized, but we still do not do anything to take the value into account. So we need to enable this flag. So I will search all the project for this specific define, so that you can see one important point is that you see that this flag, this, so there is for the moment disable code in C code, so main.c, but also in C++ code. And for that reason, we have to enable this code. We need to add this compilation flag to both compilers, both C compiler and C++ compiler. That is what we will do. So I will keep this window open to see to be sure that I type the right flag. So to modify, so this is also of course described in the slide set. We will enable the flag and then see exactly what is going on the model view presenter design pattern. So to enable this flag, I go in the properties of the project. So again, either this way or selecting the project and go to properties, and in C++ build section, then settings. And in settings, we have a tool settings tab. And this is where we can find the include path for assembler, for C compiler and for C++ compiler. We can find the libraries that we'll use. Yes, this one can be removed, by the way, because you can see that this is other previous path for external libraries. But now the proper one is set by default, so we can remove them. And also the preprocessor for C compiler and C++. So to this compilation flags, we will add the lab step one enable. And same for the C++ compilation. So I will click on this one, type Control C, the shortcut to copy to the clipboard, and go to the preprocessor, click on the last one, and Control plus V. So now I can apply and close. And this part that was disabled is now enabled. So I can relaunch the build, but first we will go through the different steps that will be impacted by this modification. So as we said in the model view presenter approach, let's go back to the slide maybe, what will happen in this case? We want the view to be updated with the system information. We know that in the model view presenter, as it is implemented, the view does not have access directly to the main application. That's the approach of the concept. So what will happen is that the model will retrieve at every frame rendering through a tick function. So the tick function of the model is a function that is called at the end of each frame rendering. When the TouchFX library renders a frame, at the end it calls the model tick function. And so if you want to do some periodical processing, you can use this function to achieve it. Or you can of course you can use a specific interrupt to do it, but the model you know that the model this model function, the tick function, will be called on each frame rendering. So the modification we added in the source code and enabled with the compilation flag, we call in this tick function a function directly from the main application, which is called temp sensor get value. This temp sensor get value is implemented, we will see in a second, in the main.c file, and we'll retrieve actually using a HAL-ADC call. We'll retrieve the junction temperature from the hardware IP, from the sensor. And then the model with this value will signal the presenter that something has happened on system level, that some information is available at system level. And it will be then up to the presenter to decide what to do. And the decision will be, as we implemented it, to signal the view that something has happened regarding the junction temperature. And the consequence of that is that the view will update the image progress value, internal value, and then at the next rendering of the library, the image progress will be updated with its new value and so its new appearance also. So this is what we will see just right now. So let's start from the model. So the lab step one enable. So we can see here that we are in the model tick function. So it's not exactly at every frame rendering, but at every 20 frame rendering, because there is an internal counter. So every 20 frame, we will call this function. This function is defined just below. It's defined here. So the get temp value, it is a separate function because we have to handle the simulator case also. Otherwise, if we will have directly called the system value here, in the simulator, this function is not defined. So that's why we use an intermediate function. And here we can use some define, specific define. So when this one is not defined, that means that the code is not for the simulator. Otherwise, the simulator is processor instruction is defined and the proper code is used instead. So in case of simulator, we return 25 every time. In terms of the target, we call this temp sensor get value, and this one is defined in the main.c. That's the one we enabled when defining the compilation flag. And we will have here the actual retrieval of the ADC value and then conversion into a temperature, an actual temperature value. So every 33 frame rendering, the model will call this temp value and use this new junction temp value to signal to the model listener that something has happened. So that's a specific mechanism that is not described in detail in this video. In fact, what we saw in the theoretical presentation is that the model is the only part of the model view presenter that is a singleton. That means that is instantiated at all time during the application, and there is only one instance of it. And on the other part, the presenter and view are a pair. There is a pair of presenter and view for each screen. You can have one screen, but also 10 or 100 screens. And only one pair of presenter and view are instantiated at a time. So when the corresponding screen is displayed. So to avoid the model to have all the instance, the list of possible screens internally, the approach is to use the model listener interface that allows, in fact, when a screen is entered, a corresponding presenter and view classes are instantiated and registered to the current model, to the only model, in fact. And the model then does not have to care which screen is available. It just calls the function that needs to be called. And if the corresponding the corresponding screen that should receive this information is instantiated, then it will use the information. Otherwise, it will do nothing. But the model is just there to signal whichever screens it's active that something happened at system level. So this is how it is done. So this function is implemented in the presenter class. It's implemented here. So a new junction temp value. So again, this code has just been enabled by our compilation flag definition. And then the screen presenter is responsible of deciding what to do. And the decision is to call the corresponding view. So there is only one view for one presenter. So it has an instance of it, which is called view. And you can call the corresponding function directly. And in the view, we can see that if the current value, the current temperature value is different of the new one, so it is passed as argument, then we update the temperature bar, and this is why the naming was so important for this one in the TouchGrafx designer when defining the layout, because it is hard-coded here. And we set the new value and we tell the library that this widget needs to be refreshed. In fact, the area of the screen that contains this widget is not more valid, is dirty, and has to be refreshed. And so internally, the library will update and send new pixels for this to the screen for this screen area. So this is how it works. The model view approach, in fact, you must see it as a tool, not as a constraint. The main interest in this approach is to really separate what is the logical of the graphical user interface, what is seen by the user, from what is done on the system part. And even on a very large project, the power of this approach is to really have two separated teams working in parallel, but on a predefined interface between from the presenter, in fact, from the presenter side. So they can work completely in parallel and do some tests and progress really in parallel thanks to this design pattern approach. So that's it. So let's now see how it works on our board. And to do that, we will use an alternate way of flashing the board using the Q programmer directly. So let's rebuild first the project, and instead of launching a debug session, we will program the generated binary file to the target directly using the Q programmer. So in the meantime, Let's go back to my webcam. So for the moment, we are still stuck in 20 degrees. And normally, after flashing this application, we should see this this image progress moving around 50 or between 50 and 60. So let's also launch in parallel the Cube Programmer. So here is the Cube Programmer interface. So I can already connect to the board. It will display the current internal flash content. While it's still compiling, I can set the external loader. So by default, you have the complete list. If you want to filter, you can just type H7B3 and then select among the one that remains. So it's the H7B3 iDisco. And then we will go to the download erase and programming section, and we will select it is not yet available, but maybe by the time we go there it will be. So the binary is created in the STM32 Cube IDE folder, in the debug folder. And that should be the previous one. Yes, it is still the previous one. So let's wait until the compilation is done. So it's done. The time is correct. So I can program, I take the X file, open it, and I can start programming. So this X file contains both internal flash and external flash datas. The internal flash will be filled with the is known by the Cube Programmer, and the external flash will be flashed using the external loader that we specified. So that's now over. So thanks to Stelling V3, the speed is quite fast. So we can see now that here, the temperature sensor, the image progress widget is moving every 20 frame every 20 frame rendering, given the internal junction temperature. So that's it for the lab 3. So again, all this is described. All the steps are described, and especially here is in the slide set, you have the way to set up properly the preprocessor, the compilation flags. You have also okay, the list of source code of source files that are impacted by this flag, and the description of each part of code, depending on the where we are in the model view presenter design pattern. So this is all available, and including of course the STM32 Cube Programmer setup and programming.